You might think of distortion as a bad thing, but that's not necessarily true. The proof of that is that even with today's ultra-clean digital technology, distortion and saturation are still regularly added into music, indicating that not all distortion is bad. The demonstrations in this video will feature some plugins from Sound Toys, which you can download using the link in the show notes below for a free trial. Thanks to Sound Toys for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. Let's start with a demonstration. Right here, I've got a 100 Hz sine wave shown on a spectrogram. Right now, it's just a line of color at 100 Hz, but watch what happens when I turn on the Sound Toys Decapitator plugin. Now we see a few additional frequencies higher up in the frequency spectrum, even though the input signal is still just a pure sine wave. And when we turn up the drive knob, we see that not only do more frequencies start to pop up, but also that the balance of those frequencies start to change depending on how the drive knob is set. When you look closer, you see that these aren't just random frequencies either. They follow a harmonic pattern. The first harmonic is our fundamental at 100 Hz, the second harmonic at 200 Hz, third harmonic at 300 Hz, fourth harmonic at 400 Hz, and so on. And look at the oscilloscope that shows the shape of the wave. As we increase the drive knob, we increase the amount of saturation that occurs, and the shape of the wave changes or becomes distorted. This is the first thing to understand when learning about saturation. The shape of the waveform on an oscilloscope and the balance of the harmonic frequencies on a frequency analyzer graph are one and the same. Two ways of understanding the same thing. Let me explain what I mean. Remember the harmonic pattern we saw? 100 Hz, 200 Hz, 300 Hz, and so on. The second, fourth, sixth, and other even order harmonics are even multiples of the fundamental frequency. In this case, that's 200 Hz, 400 Hz, 600 Hz, etc. The third, fifth, seventh, and other odd order harmonics are odd multiples of the fundamental frequency. 300 Hz, 500 Hz, 700 Hz, etc. It's often said that even order harmonics are generally more pleasing than odd order harmonics. And while there is some truth to that, they all have a place in music, as you'll see in the practical demonstrations later in the video. But before we get there, I want to show you a few types of waveforms that highlight the relationship between wave shape and harmonic content. Let's start with a triangle wave. A triangle wave consists of only odd order harmonics. In this case, we see a triangle wave with a fundamental frequency of 1 Hz on the graph. And on the frequency graph, we see that this wave also contains odd order harmonics, like 3 Hz, 5 Hz, 7 Hz, 9 Hz, and so on. And the relative level of each harmonic frequency decreases the further you go from the fundamental frequency. The second wave I want to show you is a square wave. Notice that the frequencies in a square wave are exactly the same as the triangle wave, but this time they taper at a less drastic rate. The same frequencies with a different relative balance will result in a much different sound, as you can hear. Finally, when we look at a sawtooth wave, we see that it consists of odd and even order harmonics. The waveform resembles the linear rise of the triangle wave with the instantaneous drop of the square wave. And again, the resulting sound is easily distinguishable from the others. Now you might be asking yourself, why does changing the shape of a wave result in additional frequencies? And this is where it gets very interesting. Every complex waveform can be built by simply layering higher frequency sine waves together. If you were to put the fundamental frequency 1 Hz and its third harmonic 3 Hz on a graph, it would look like this. But if you've ever zoomed in on a DAW to see what all of the frequencies in your music look like, you wouldn't see a bunch of separate sine waves like this. You'd see one very complex wave that represents the combined amplitude and frequency of every instrument in the mix. When we converge 1 Hz and 3 Hz, it creates a wave that is slightly flattened on the top. Add another odd-order harmonic, and the waveform flattens out even more. And when we keep adding more and more odd-order harmonics, They eventually sum together to create something that looks a lot like a square wave. Remember, the lower frequencies have much greater amplitude compared to the higher frequencies. So the resulting sum of all of these frequencies resembles the fundamental sine wave with very quick transitions from positive to negative and from negative to positive. To bring this back to the idea of mixing with saturation, think about what happens when you slowly increase the signal level in a completely linear system. The amplitude grows larger, but the shape of the wave is otherwise unchanged. Of course, completely linear audio systems don't exist in the real world. A digital system can be totally linear up until a certain point, but when you exceed 0 dB full scale in a fixed point digital system, you immediately see a lot of distortion in the form of clipping. The top of the waveform is chopped off, resulting in a shape that can be understood as the sum of many higher frequency sine waves. In the analog realm, we start to see non-linearities even before exceeding the intended limit of the circuit. That's because the shape of the waveform is somewhat changed or distorted even within the intended operating levels. This causes problems in some cases, but it brings richness, vibe, and warmth in other cases. And it's one of the biggest factors that make analog hardware so sought after, and it's the reason why these style options in the SoundToys Decapitator plugin were modeled after classic analog gear. The A style was modeled after the Ampex 350 tape drive preamp. The E style was modeled after the Chandler EMI TG channel. The N style was modeled after the Neve 1057 input channel. The T style was modeled after the Culture Vulture triode setting, and the P style was modeled after the Culture Vulture pentode setting. Notice that the balance of odd and even harmonics that arise with each of these styles are unique, and also notice that adjusting the drive setting in any one of these styles results in a unique nonlinear outcome. I get a lot of comments saying that gain staging is obsolete, but here's one of many instances where that is incorrect. Because not only do the style and drive settings impact the behavior of this plugin, but so does the input, meaning that the behavior will be different based on the amplitude and frequency content of the input signal. And right here, we've got the SoundToys radiator with its own unique sound. Just running a signal through this plugin and the Altec mixer after which it's modeled can have an effect. Listen to the before and after on drums. These nonlinear plugins are designed to bring some life back into the digital realm. Because even though digital has a lot of benefits, it sometimes lacks that analog flavor that's been sprinkled into records over the last century. Now, I want to share with you a few of the many ways you can mix with saturation. Use the link below to download the free trial of the plugins and apply these techniques in your own music. First off, let me mention that the examples are going to be pretty obvious in some cases, in order to convey the impacts of saturation in an educational way that everybody can hear. There are ways to use saturation in very obvious ways and extremely subtle ways. So I encourage you to try it for yourself in your own mixing environment. One example of where you might use saturation in a very obvious way is to alter the timbre of an instrument to prevent it from getting lost in a mix, or to balance a mix when there's a lack of energy in the mid and high frequencies. Listen to this. In this example, I've purposefully left out some of the other tracks that would normally fill the higher frequency ranges. But let's pretend for the sake of this video that this is the arrangement and nothing can be done about that. Even though I'd recommend getting the arrangement right before calling it done. But anyway, while you can sometimes fill in the higher frequency ranges with a simple EQ boost, maybe there isn't enough energy in the desired frequency range to simply boost with EQ. In these cases, you might use saturation to redistribute energy from lower frequencies into higher frequency ranges that aren't already present. When I solo the 808 sample, we see and hear that there's energy up to about 300 Hz, but not much above that. Using Decapitator, we can saturate the track, which will result in harmonically related energy higher in the spectrum. This is important. It's not just random noise. It's actually an extension of the original signal. It kind of messes up the tone of the 808 when you just crank up the drive. So to preserve the dry tone while enhancing the higher frequencies, we can try dialing back the amount of wet signal, just blending in the amount we need. Another instance where you might use saturation is to allow for low-frequency instruments to be heard on playback systems that are limited in their ability to produce low frequencies. This is often more subtle because you don't necessarily want to use saturation as an effect in your mix, but instead you want to use it to simply excite frequencies that are harmonically related to a particular instrument so that that element can be heard even on a smartphone speaker. Let's take, for example, the kick drum in this song. Coming through pretty well on full range speakers, but what if we played it back on a smartphone, which has small speakers that will effectively high pass what the listener is hearing? Now it's much more difficult to hear the kick, although you can still hear it because that kick does have some higher frequency content already. But if we were to use saturation on the kick, we'll generate some more higher frequency content that can be reproduced by the smartphone. So even though the smartphone can't provide the full tone of the kick drum as you'd get on full range speakers, at least you know the kick drum is there. And our minds will often reverse engineer those higher frequencies, leading to somewhat of a phantom fundamental frequency that's not really there, even though you can perceive it. Of course, you need to find a balance where there's enough saturation to achieve this effect, but not so much as to damage the tone of the instrument. Saturation has been a part of classic recordings throughout the decades. That's because analog gear is nonlinear, meaning you can't always predict the output simply based on the input and a simple function. This has led to lots of experimentation with different circuits over those decades and has defined what sounds good, rich, warm, brittle, and nostalgic for all of us. Productions just keep evolving based on what came before them, which I find very cool. One particularly iconic example of this is a saturation effect on a vocal. You can use lots of saturation for the overdrive effect you might hear in a Black Keys album or a Sam Cooke recording, similar to this. Whoa, whoa. Or you can tone it back a bit by dialing back the drive knob. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Or you can keep the drive knob high and dial it back by blending it in with the mix knob. Whoa, 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 baby, we're gold. The more subtle uses are again not so much a special effect, but rather a way to spread out energy throughout the spectrum in a way that sounds organic and harmonically related to the source. It's not just an EQ boost. Rather than boosting frequencies, it's creating frequencies that weren't there before. I've heard this described as a halo effect, and I think that's a really helpful way of understanding how to hear saturation in many cases. Listen to the distortion of the fundamental, but understand that the effects you'll hear with saturation will extend upward in the frequency spectrum. Here's a final example, but this one is very important because it demonstrates that saturation can be harnessed through the use of other tools, not just saturation plugins. Now I've added an aggressive compressor plugin called Soundtoy's Devil Lock Deluxe into another plugin called Plugin Doctor. If the plugin is bypassed, this line will just be straight because the input and output have a one-to-one relationship. But when I engage the plugin, let's see what happens. The behavior is seemingly linear up until the point where the threshold is reached. Then there's some reduction between the input and output, and that means the waveform will be distorted. Putting this on drums will therefore achieve some of that same harmonic distortion we've been discussing, which can be really cool in parallel, using the mix knob, or as an effect on room mics to create a very big drum sound. This is just one of the infinite ways to use a compressor to add color to a mix. A very important point I'm trying to make is that saturation and harmonic distortion are inevitable in any nonlinear signal path. Because when you change the shape of the waveform, you change the frequency components that make it up, and vice versa. So the next time you're dialing in a limiter or compressor, listen not only for the changes to the envelope and dynamics of the sound, but also to the distortion that will occur, exciting higher frequency harmonics. In other words, compressors and limiters aren't just dynamics processors, but they're also spectral processors with the ability to shape the frequency balance of a mix. These saturation techniques and effects can be applied to individual instruments, buses, or even effects like delay. In fact, the Soundtoy's Echo Boy plugin has a built-in saturation effect for exactly this purpose. In the next video with Soundtoy's, we'll be looking into the evolution of delay. I'll put that video here when it's ready, but be sure to download the free trial of these plugins with the link below in the meantime and start applying what you've already learned here. I'll see you in the next video.